الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين، فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جزيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأوردنا حوضه واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم أمين. My dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has been talking to us in the Quran a lot about the Quran. So, and we have been talking about the Quran for the past few weeks, and I want to continue to share with you when the Quran talks how unique it is, how practical it is, how impressive it is, and how spiritual it is. It gives you what the hadith that we cited last week. The hadith says, "Fihi khabaru ma qablakum." It does have the history of what happened before you. You see, history is a foundation for what is yet to come after. That's why nations who do not study history, they are bound to repeat the same flaws, the same mistakes, again and again and again. So the Quran makes the point that we must know history, our history, and the history of other communities and other nations. So فيه خبر ما قبلكم. It does have the news about what happened before you. وحكم ما بينكم. And it has the judgment and the ruling related to what you are going through. Very central. Because a book that doesn't give you the answer to your current contemporary questions becomes irrelevant. It becomes irrelevant to my life. What is the benefit of a book that doesn't tell me what to do when I face A, B, or C? So the Quran, according to the description of the hadith, it gives us that also. So it's not only old tales and stories that we tend to call history. No, it also is as contemporary as every generation carries this book into its reality for their own benefit to get the answer. Imagine if you have a GPS that is 10, 15 years old. How good is it compared to an updated version of the same GPS? Of course, the updated one will give you the new bridges, the new exits, the new highways. Where is it? A dead end? It will tell you. So the Quran, one of the amazing miracles of the Quran is it does not need updates. Why doesn't it need updates? Because it's not made by humans. It's come from Allah. But a book that required people to change it, it means it was done by people. That's why people see fit to correct what others didn't know in their time. In our case, the Quran is as updated as it can get. And this is a process that is standing as a normal characteristic of the Quran. You want to seek some ruling regarding your relationship with your friend or wife, who's right, who's wrong. Go to the Quran, it will tell you. And if the Quran does not include your very specific situation, at least it generally tells us go to the teachings of the Prophet. So the Prophet becomes the embodiment of the Quran, and the Quran becomes the primary and ultimate reference for everything. Third, the Hadith also told us, and we cited this last week, وَنَبَأُ مَا بَعْدَكُمْ. Does it talk also about the future? Yes. So it gives us the news that are yet to happen, not only for us, but for communities and generations after us. Hence, the Prophet ﷺ cites for us, the Quran spoke about the Day of Judgment, right? And the Sunnah explained what are the signs of the Day of Judgment? When does it become close? What signs should I look for as a generation? Is it our time? Is it somebody else's time? And you find that this amazing combinations of past, present, and future, very, very impressive indeed. It's one and the same book, and every generation finds in it whatever they need. This is the ultimate miracle of the Quran. And in the same hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, وَلَا يَخْلَقُ عَنْ كَثْرَةِ الرَّدِّ. It never gets too old to answer our needs. What more do we need? So this is the book that we are talking about. And today I'm going to go with you in a journey to explore some of the amazing stories of the Quran, which we are all familiar with parts of it. So we're going to go over the parts that we are not as familiar because they are not spoken of very much. So here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us in Surah Al-Isra, the Surah of the Ascension. And that Surah also is equally named the story of Bani Israel, Surah Bani Israel. Well, Bani Israel, as we all know, are mentioned all throughout the Quran. After all, those were the people that Allah sent about 20,000 prophets. They are as old as history. They are as old as history. Talk about the days of Ya'qub, the son of Ishaq, the son of Ibrahim. These are very old days. They are called Bani Israel. And the word Bani Israel could mean exclusively the children of Ya'qub, which means the 12 children of Ya'qub, Yusuf and his siblings. They could also mean Yusuf and his siblings and descendants. Descendants would mean all generations who have blood lineage to those 12 children, hence to Ya'qub. It could also mean, amazingly, the community of the children of Israel and or anyone who joined them in faith. So not only by lineage, but also associate co-religionists, people who believe the same and joined the children of Israel as faithful believers of the message of Musa alayhi salam, or as followers of Ya'qub and the following generations of his. So this is the definition, or definitions rather, of the children of Israel as the term is used in the Quran. So when you hear the word Ya Bani Israel, it could mean any of the three definitions. Okay? So this surah, Surah Al-Isra, is called Surah Bani Israel, which will tell us partly some of the stories of the children of Israel, but it will give us a theme that we will go over in the next few weeks to get to know the context of where does Islam fit in the context of the history in relationship to the religions or the religion as it was given to the children of Yaqub and Bani Israel and so on and so forth. So from the beginning it talks about Al-Isra. سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى. It's quite a start in the surah. All praise is due to the one who has أسرى means to travel at night. So الإسراء is a night journey. Okay? So the one who has taken his servant. So when the Prophet was picked from Al-Masjid Al-Haram to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, Allah calls him by the most beloved title. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lots of names. Lots of names. He calls him Abdina, like here, Abdihi, like here. وَأَنَّهُ لَمَّا قَامَ عَبْدُنَا يَدْعُوهُ Surah Al-Jinn, when our servant stood up to call them unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he calls him يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ, right? He calls him يَا أَيُّهَا الرَّسُولُ. He calls him يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُدَّثِّرُ, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُزَّمِّلُ. All of these are names, some of them are Asma' Alam, which are specific names, some of which are descriptive names of the Prophet. Here, Abdihi, he did not call him here messenger. He called him Abdihi. What does Abd denote, or connote rather? And it is different from Rasulihi. Rasul is a title of the highest work the Prophet has done. But here it is Abd. Abd connotes submissiveness, to submit to Allah. And this is what Allah loves the most about any human being, to become Abd. To become Abd means we have responded to the call of all Prophets, اعبدوا الله ولا تشركوا به شيئا. Worship Allah and associate none with him. سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا. ليلا is what told us that أسرى is a night journey. At night. من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى. From the holy mosque in Mecca to the Aqsa Mosque, all the way north, about 2 months travel. And Laylan here also points to the fact that this happened in one and the same night. Because you cannot travel this whole distance Laylan if it's taking days. Days, it will be Laylan and Naharan, night and day. So the word Laylan here is to draw our attention that Allah means that that journey took only the night. So I'm not going to go into all the details, but I'm passing through as quickly as I can so that I don't lose what the ayat are saying. إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله. This Aqsa Mosque that we have blessed all around it. So where is the blessed Holy Land? The Holy Land that is blessed by Allah is Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa and the surrounding area. All the surrounding area is blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is the purpose of this journey? لِنُرِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا. So that we may show him some of our signs, miracles, things that he could not see on his own. إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. Allah is the one who hears all and sees all. Then, وَآتَيْنَا مُوسَى الْكِتَابِ. So what is the connection between this introduction to the journey of Isra' and jumping to talking about Moses. And then the next ayah will talk about directly Bani Israel in the same sentence. Okay? So what is the connection? The connection is Allah always, if you read Surah Al-A'raf, and you see every prophet coming after Nuh, because the first story there is the story of Nuh, and then the second story is the story of Hud with his people, Qawm Ad. You will notice that every time a prophet comes, they refer to the prophet before them as a backdrop for lessons, for experiments, for stories that should be benefited from. And the prophet keeps telling his community, like Hud was telling Ad, and remember, as you have been successors to the people of Nuh, he has made you successors. خُلَفَاءَ مِنْ بَعْدِ قَوْمِ نُوحٍ. So if you are a successor of a community, you ought to take lessons. You ought to hear their experience and their relationship with their message, with their prophet, with Allah, how much they benefited from their message. That's the purpose here. So the relationship here is addressing our ummah, not to brag about Prophet Muhammad is the one who was taken and ascended and this. No, no, no. The point here is take lessons. The ascension journey, which is Al-Mi'raj, is meant to show the Prophet the ayat that the ayah is talking about. So we got those ayat. The Prophet spoke about his journey, and we got some miracles just to assure us that the Prophet ﷺ is from Allah and that he could not have traveled on his own in one night between Mecca and Jerusalem on his own. He could not. There are details, I'm not going to go into those because they will take a lot of time. I want to focus on the lessons. So here is وَآتَيْنَا مُوسَى الْكِتَابِ, and we have given Moses the book. What is the book that was given to Moses? It is the Torah. So immediately Allah is telling us, as you have a book, as you have a prophet, the community before you, they also had a prophet, and the prophet was given a book. And their book was meant to be similar to your book in the sense that it is guidance to the children of Israel. هُدًى وَجَعَلْنَاهُ هُدًى لِبَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. We have made this book as a reference and guidance to the children of Israel. So what is the central message there? أَلَّا تَتَّخِذُوا مِن دُونِي وَكِيلًا. Don't take any agent, any supporter. Don't give allegiance to anyone other than Allah. So this part is as much for Bani Israel as it is for us as well. We should never leave the book of Allah and seek guidance from any other source. We should never try to follow anybody but our prophet and the book that came with him. أَلَّا تَتَّخِذُوا مِن دُونِي وَكِيلًا. Then comes another strange statement. Ayah number 3. ذُرِّيَّةَ مَنْ حَمَلْنَا مَعَ نُوحٍ. It took me years to get to understand the connection. ذُرِّيَّةَ مَنْ حَمَلْنَا مَعَ نُوحٍ. These are, they and you are the descendants of the children of Nuh. So again, the ayah is pointing that everybody who comes from Adam are children of Adam. Everybody who was saved or created after Nuh, he is one progeny to one man, Prophet Nuh. We are all his descendants. And this will become very significantly important, inshallah, maybe next week we can explain this because time is not on our side, but at least I would like to invite you to read only 3 ayat of Surah Al-Isra, Surah Bani Israel at home. Read it, read whatever tafsir that you could lay hands on in the comfort language that you feel easy with, and come inshallah next week to continue to see where are we heading with what the Quran is telling us and how central and important it is, considering the context we spoke of last week. فيه خبر ما قبلكم. It includes the news that happened before you, for people and communities before you. وحكم ما بينكم, and the ruling regarding what is happening amongst yourselves. ونبأ ما بعدكم, and the news that is yet to come after you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us understand the Quran, to understand our reality, to understand our history, and to understand how to plan for our future. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه. اللهم اجمعنا معه يوم نلقاك على طاعتك. So, ألا تتخذوا من دوني وكيلا ذرية من حملنا مع نوح. Who is Nuh? Again, listen to this. إِنَّهُ كَانَ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. So he calls Muhammad Abd. He mentions Moses in the middle without calling him anything. And he mentions Nuh as Abd, which surely makes Moses a Abd. And his community are supposed to follow this Abd, which means they are supposed to submit as he does. Which spells, or dispels rather, the notion that Allah has favorite people. And Allah only favors the obedient, the submissive ones. Those believers who follow His commands, these are His favorites. So, إِنَّهُ كَانَ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. We will get you the story and why the story of Nuh is relevant in this context, inshallah, next week if Allah allows us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enlighten our hearts, expand our knowledge, and open our heart to accept His revelation. Allahumma ahdina fi man hadayt, wa'afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa qina wasrif anna sharra ma qadayt. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين. اللهم لا تدع لنا في يومنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا دينا إلا قضيته، ولا مريضا إلا شفيته، ولا مبتلا إلا عافيته، ولا سائلا إلا أعطيته، ولا مدينا إلا قضيت دينه، ولا ضالا إلا هديته، ولا ميتا إلا رحمته، ولا مجاهدا إلا نصرته. اللهم انصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان، اللهم انصر عبادك المظلومين في كل مكان، اللهم عليك بالظالمين فإنهم لا يعجزونك. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.